My name is Glenn Brand, Superintendent of Schools, and again, thank you for being here this evening. Tonight really marks an important occasion as we think about the future of the district. Doran Whittier, our consultants who are here tonight, and I'll turn the mic over to Lee Doran in just a minute, have been, as some of you might know, been working in the district for the last year and a half or so, a little bit more than that, in fact. When the school committee hired me as a superintendent approximately 2.5 years ago, one of the priorities that I know that they shared very clearly with me was an interest in the capital and the infrastructure of the district and our almost 1 million square feet and 8 buildings, and the concern around trying to ensure that as we move forward and looked ahead to ensure that we have buildings and classrooms that can support teaching and learning, there was a keen interest in focusing in on our capital and infrastructure needs. We, through an open bid process, went out a little over a year and a half ago, and through that process hired Doran Whittier to consult what we've now termed as phase one, or the existing condition study. If you're not familiar with that term or that concept, that phase one report was the culmination of work that they did to dig into and understand all of our buildings, on the roof, underground, and in the walls, and really a state-of-the-state assessment of what the infrastructure needs are currently and to move forward over time. So that existing condition study report is up, it's online. It was presented, the findings, to the school committee a number of months ago. And it was with the continuation of the support of the school committee that we entered into phase two, which tonight really brings us to the close, and you'll hear their report. Phase two, otherwise known as the district master plan, moved one step further than just analyzing the state of our buildings, but looked more holistically, and I know Lee will do a better job than I in terms of sort of describing the parameters of this, but ultimately looked more holistically at an understanding of what our needs are currently, what our projections and our projections, student projections might lead to in the near future, and what options might emerge for our communities of Acton-Boxborough to consider going forward to provide us the greatest leverage for improving our buildings. So that's the backdrop for this evening, and this brings to the close their work and their report to our community. So with that, I'll turn it over to Lee.
Thanks, Glenn, and thanks for all of you coming out tonight. I know it's a busy time of year. With me tonight is Jason Boone, Rob Fitzgerald, and Emily Ray, who've been working diligently for us, as Glenn mentioned, for quite a while. I think it's been 20 months, 4 days, 10 hours, and 15 minutes. But in that time frame, we've done a vast amount of work, and we're going to try and condense that for you tonight into about 60 slides. So feel free to ask questions, because there's lots of detail in here, and we'll try and drill down and really kind of hit the salient points for you. Glenn mentioned kind of a two-step process, and just to get into a little more detail of it, phase one, which was kind of the physical assessment of buildings, we finished last January, before we started phase two, and we spent a lot of time going through all of the existing buildings, and what we were looking for really is infrastructure needs, deferred maintenance needs, and trying to compile a list of items that needed to get completed with line item cost estimates, so you can have an order of magnitude of what it's going to take to extend the life cycle of these buildings for another 50 years. Now, that lens that we used at looking at the buildings didn't take into account any of the educational issues within the buildings, adjacencies of classrooms, appropriate size classrooms, et cetera. That was all part of phase two. The result of our phase one work came up with a pretty significant number of dollars and issues that needed to be addressed, and it was around $120 million of work that needs to be accomplished. And if the district was to undertake that on its own, there would be no state participation in potential reimbursement for that. So what we did is we took that a next step further and said if we were looking to try and look at positioning the district for the next 50 years, we really need to take that capital improvement list and kind of marry it up with all the educational needs within the district and what the vision is for the district, you know, for the foreseeable future. That work potentially has the ability to get some grant money from the Massachusetts School Building Assistance Program. And The district has had a couple of projects that they've run through that before, but we want to talk to you about that because that has, you know, getting state money into this certainly helps the financial picture locally. So phase one looked at physical building issues. Phase two looked at spaces within the building, what the educational vision was moving forward, enrollment projections. Everything comes down to enrollment projections because that really drives square footage and space needs, and ultimately, how does your building existing inventory match up to that in the future? Key planning issues, and we developed a series of options that we're going to go through with you tonight. We didn't pick a final option. I think we've got a menu of things available for the district to look at and review further. And we have cost estimates, good orders of magnitude, to be able to compare those options against each other. The agenda tonight, and I won't go through this, is really to talk about some of the key planning issues and the strategies that we used. Option differentiators, things for you guys to consider when you're looking at some of these options. We have a short list of options. We started with a huge number, and we've brought it down to something a little bit more manageable. Cost estimates and potential next steps. So the big question is, you know, what is a master plan and why are we doing it? And, you know, the definition of master plan is a document that defines the scope and sequence of work to a district's facilities that is necessary to fulfill its educational mission over a fixed time frame. Lots of questions about that, and these were questions we were trying to attempt to answer, is what is the physical condition of all of your school facilities? That was kind of phase one. How are they performing educationally? How many schools should there be? How big should each school be? What are the grade configuration options available within the district? Where should all the schools be located, since you are a regional district? And what do we need to do as far as planning a roadmap to get us there? So these are all key planning issues. I'm going to turn this over to Jason right now to talk to us a little bit in more detail. And then we'll have some period at the end to be able to review in more detail some of these options that we have up here. So I'll turn it over to Jason.
As Lee mentioned, a master plan asks the really big picture questions, asks the really high level questions, and we went through an entire process to try to respond to each one of those. And I'm going to try to be brief. We do have a moment in here scheduled where we'd like you to ask questions and we can provide additional detail if necessary at that time. We also have a feedback exercise planned at the end of the evening, as both Dr. Brandon Lee mentioned. Our study has ended without a single one selected option, right? There's a short list of options, which you saw when you came in the door this evening. And the exercise that we have planned tonight is the start of continuing the dialogue with you, the local citizens, about what the preferred direction really is. Right, so that's how we're going to conclude this evening. When we talk about those big picture planning issues, these are the ones that we're talking about, and we've mentioned these a couple of times. The one thing we didn't really talk about is we formed an 80-person visioning group where we invited members of the local communities, parents, faculty, staff, teachers, and we had a wonderful group of students who we discussed a lot of these big picture issues in our analysis with, and they provided feedback that helped shape not only the options but ultimately the shortlist that we're sharing with you. To quickly go back over phase one, we realize that some of you may not have been here when that work was presented, and we're not certain who is familiar with where we are in the process, so we want to make sure we cover all of our bases. We did evaluate all of the school facilities in the district. We also evaluated the administration building and the maintenance facility in terms of their physical condition. So we did do a broad spectrum analysis of physical condition across the district. And we've summarized those findings in this graphic. It's a basic stoplight metaphor. If it's red, the physical needs are greater. If it's yellow, the physical needs are less. If it's green, it's probably okay for right now. So in a quick eye sweep, you can see that Douglas, Conant, and Gates rose to the top in terms of the school facilities, in terms of their physical need. In addition to them, both the administration building and the maintenance building would sort of fall next in line, although they're not school facilities. So in the spring, the district filed a statement of interest with the MSBA based on this information to say, we would like you to consider our district for participation in your grant program for one or multiple of these three elementary schools. And so as a summary of that, Douglas Gates and Conants are in significant long-term need, and Lee mentioned this dollar figure already. Roughly $120 million of deferred maintenance was identified just in physical needs. That's not including any educational upgrades that we found in phase two. And although there are some limited MSBA programs for this kind of work, almost all of this money would likely be at the two towns' sole expense. When we cross over into phase two, we looked at different issues. Lee mentioned some of them. I'll just quickly run down them on the side. We looked at capacity of buildings in a couple of different ways. We looked at how instructional spaces compared to the state's benchmarks. We looked at class size. We looked at utilization rate. This is a measure of how efficiently we're using spaces in the building, how often during the school day are instructional spaces occupied by children. Low utilization rates might suggest we need fewer spaces. High utilization rates might suggest we need more spaces. And then finally, this notion of missing or temporary spaces. Those of you who are familiar with the existing buildings know that there are certain places where instruction is happening in spaces that are less than ideal, or happening in modular spaces, or they don't exist at all. Those things would have fallen into that category. And if we look at, again, the same stoplight metaphor, where the greatest needs are, it turned out that the same three elementary schools are in the greatest educational need that were in the greatest physical need. GFCR? Oh, I'm sorry, yes, thank you, good question. Gross square footage, right, and classroom count. They're just two different techniques for measuring a building's capacity. Part of the reason we do that is we want to make sure everybody understands the nuance of both of those methodologies, because they can tell very different stories. In fact, I'll use Douglas as the example. In terms of classroom count, the capacity was much higher because there's, you know, approximately the right number of classrooms. But by gross square footage, it was incredibly over capacity because the cafeteria is really small and the gym is really small and the library is in a modular, right? There are some missing spaces there that by that metric would suggest it's really overcrowded. Yes, sir. It does, but this is where we got to be a little bit careful getting to the detail right now. Douglas was actually overcrowded by both metrics, but it was.
You just said it was okay on the classroom count. I thought you just said that a second ago. You referred to another school.
If I said that, I misspoke. I apologize. What's on the graphic is correct, but it was the calculations demonstrated that it was. Overcapacity by different amounts in each of the two methodologies, okay? There were a couple of enrollment projections performed during the course of the study, and it turns out that they were a little bit far apart over the 10-year window that we were looking at. So we got those two demographers together, and we reconciled those enrollment projections for purposes of the study. As Lee mentioned, this is a very important step to take. The big picture message here is that after this reconciled enrollment, everybody agreed that the trajectory of the district enrollment is downward for the next 10 years, but that housing stock is going to start to turn over, and that over a 20-year time horizon, which is what this dotted line represents, is that there's an expectation that the enrollment is actually going to turn around and may reach a peak similar to where it was way back in 2005, 2006. Right? So that creates a little bit of a dilemma for the district. The MSBA only looks at a 10-year window when it produces its enrollment projection, so we sort of have that window to think about. But the district also doesn't want to sort of paint itself in a corner should the enrollment uptick again in the next 10 years. So ultimately what the school committee decided to do was to pick grade level enrollment targets that were right around the earliest possible enrollment for any major project that the MSBA might participate with. And we used those enrollment targets as the basis of our options development, right? This is all, you know, study phase planning. So the district is going to have to continue to look at enrollment, and should they engage the MSBA with a major project, there has to be clarification around what the enrollment is, but we use these to establish targets for our options to do our test fitting across the district. I mentioned the visioning sessions. We had three of them, and they each had a little different focus. The first visioning session was largely about the future of education and the trajectory of education around the country. The second one was about big picture planning issues, things like school count, school size, grade configuration. And then the third one was about options. And so these are some of the high level findings from those three visioning sessions. From the first visioning session, there was an interest in continuing all of the great educational things that are already happening in the district, and perhaps even pushing that a little bit further with 21st century teaching and learning. In addition to that, out of the first visioning session came a realization that because of the physical condition of the junior high, the building that we're in, and the high school, there may be a need to identify a third sort of stream of money. We've talked about the really big capital project. We've talked about the capital improvement, you know, maintenance repair projects. But particularly at the junior high and the high school, maybe there's a need for something small but in the middle of those two to improve the learning environment in these two facilities. And so that's what these three buckets of spending are meant to reflect: a maintenance bucket, a sort of a medium bucket, and then this major capital bucket. Out of visioning session number two, the big key finding was an interest in exploring more grade configurations than maybe any of us anticipated coming into the study. Currently, you have a pre-K, K through 6, 7 through 8, 9 through 12 grade configuration. Those in attendance at the visioning session suggested we should look at two alternatives, two variations of that. One that involved an early childhood center, grouping pre-K and K for the entire district together in one facility, and another variation that explored a conventional 6 through 8 middle school, which would obviously change the grade configuration at the elementary schools. So we listened to that feedback, and ultimately we developed a range of options that explored all three of those variations. And what made the short list was at least one option from each one of those grade configurations. And then finally, after we presented those options to the visioning group, one of the things that they provided in terms of feedback was, regardless of what's happening with the grade configuration, it's important to keep an elementary school in the town of Boxborough. So over the summer, we've taken all of this feedback, all of this analysis, and we started synthesizing it into a series of options. And the options differed from one another in three basic ways. They varied in grade configuration, they varied in school count, and I'll define that in just a minute, and they differed in building count. When we say school, we look across the parking lot to the Parker Damon building. What we mean by school is Merriam is a school and McCarthy Town is a school. Parker Damon is a building. Okay? So Blanchard is both a school and a building. Right? But some of our options explore the notion of a twin building that has two schools in it. So we want to make sure everybody's clear that the nomenclature is what it is for a reason. And so in terms of grade configuration, the working group wanted us to elaborate on that just a little bit. Because historically, and this happens all across the Commonwealth, school districts are making the grade configuration decision often based on where there's room. Right? I would suspect that that's how pre-K ended up over at the administration building. Right? It's how pre-K ended up over at Blanchard. It's how this building is only 7 through 8 and maybe not, you know, something else. So what we asked our visioning group was, where do you think the natural developmental breaks occur? What if we were to do this intentionally based on educational or psychological or developmental reasons instead of spatial reasons? And what they came up with was, all right, well, let's look at where developmental breaks are. What would constitute a critical mass of professionals? For example, when you spread pre-kindergarten out, you don't have all of those folks able to work together for that specific age group. When you have kindergarten, first grade, whatever it is, right, spread out, perhaps you don't have a critical mass of professionals to specialize in a particular age group. It turns out that the statewide frameworks and curricula play a role in this kind of decision. The example we cite there is that turns out the sixth grade frameworks and curricula are written more like middle school than they are like elementary school. So we debated a lot about where should sixth grade go. Should it remain at the elementary school for, you know, developmental reasons? My sixth grader is more like a fifth grader than it is like, you know, a seventh grader. Or should we do it the other way because of how the curriculum is written? And then I already talked about the educational versus facility decision making. And so it was this conversation that led to the notion of an early childhood center and perhaps a conventional middle school as alternative models. And so here's ultimately what we explored, 15 different options, right, that were variations of each of those three differentiators. So we had three grade configurations. We had four different building counts. Some options had five. Others went all the way down to just two elementary school buildings in the district. And then three different school counts, as few as four elementary schools in the district. Now, obviously, the fewer buildings that you have, the more students are in each one. There's an economy of scale to be gained, perhaps operationally, or from a faculty and staff point of view, the fewer buildings and fewer schools that you have. Our working group looked at lots of different considerations when evaluating the options that we prepared. The big picture items that stemmed from the the impetus of the master plan are there on the left. But then there are a whole other host of things that the working group looked at too. Most notably, what's the impact to students? Right? What are the educational advantages to these various options? Those criteria were ultimately weighted based on their importance. They were scored, and we developed a short list, which is what we have on the boards this evening. I think in total there are six on the short list option. Rather than being sort of strict about the methodology, the working group decided that it was important to retain at least one option from each of the three different grade configurations. So it wasn't the strict, you know, highest scores among everything. It was sort of the highest scores among each grade configuration. So there's at least one in the mix. And then finally, after we presented them to the visioning session number three, we actually dropped one more from the shortlist based on the feedback that we heard from them. And so here they are. I'll try to go through these fairly quickly, but this is probably the most important portion of the evening. So in option C, here are the schools across the top, the administration building, Blanchard, Conant, Douglas, Gates, the Parker Damon building, RJ Gray Junior High, the high school, and any new buildings that are being proposed as part of the option. So you can see right away that the administration building, Douglas and Gates, in this option would no longer exist as instructional facilities. That doesn't necessarily mean that the building would be, you know, turned over or sold or somehow abandoned as a district property. Just it wouldn't exist as a school with children in it anymore. Instead, what this option proposes is a two-step process where a new twin school would be built on the Gates property. It's really difficult to see here, but there's an outline of the existing building right there. And so what we truth tested was, could you actually fit a twin school on that site while the Gates school is still in operation, move children in, and then ultimately knock the building down to make parking and play fields on that site? And the truth test demonstrated that, at least at this level of exploration, it appears to be theoretically feasible to do that. That's step one. In step two, the Conant site would be converted to an early childhood center by renovations and potentially additions. And so those two steps, the first one opening in approximately 2022 in the fastest possible scenario, and the second step, the early childhood center at Conant opening in approximately 2028, again in the fastest possible scenario. And I'll communicate the cost of all of these in just a minute. In the next option, option D, it's similar in that the administration building Conant, Douglas, and Gates all are discontinued as educational facilities. The first project, instead of being a twin school with two elementary schools in it, would be one elementary school, grades 1 through 6, and the Early Childhood Center. Again, on the Gates property. And you can see very similar siting. This enrollment would be a little less, and therefore the building would be a little smaller. And then in step two, we truth tested an all new elementary school on the Douglas site. Again, you can just make out the existing Douglas facility right here, that we could put a freestanding new elementary school on that property while the Douglas building was still occupied if necessary. Similar timeline, the first project could be completed as early as 2022. The second step would be completed as early as 2028. So both of these options are the Early Childhood Center, grades 1 through 6 at the elementary level, grades 7 and 8 here at the junior high, and grades 9 through 12 at the high school. Option E is one more of those, except instead of being a two-step solution, this is a single-step solution. And what this explored is the possibility of actually building a triple school, again, on the Gates property. You can see that it's much bigger. In fact, in this case, it does overlap the existing building a little bit, so that changes the phasing slightly. But again, we believe it's theoretically feasible to execute this plan. And that building would not only house two elementary schools, but it would also house the Early Childhood Center. So in terms of student enrollment, you can just see them here, 347, 421, and 421. We're looking at well over 1,000 children in that one facility. Part of the advantage of this, though, is that the entire master plan would be complete in just one step. Right, so essentially more money up front, but much fewer steps and a much faster time to completion. Transitioning to option I, now we're changing the grade configuration. This is the one option that looks at a conventional 6 through 8 middle school. So we tested the feasibility of actually placing an addition on this building to bring all of the district's 6th graders into this facility. And so again, the admin building, Douglas and Gates in this case, would go offline as educational facilities. The first step would be to place an addition here at RJ Gray. The resulting population would be around 1,300 children. We didn't explore in a lot of detail what the site impact would be in terms of numbers of vehicles and site circulation. We only tested that it was theoretically possible to put an addition of this size on the back of this property, sort of up the hill here. In step two, a freestanding elementary school, again, on the Gates property, because it's only a single school, not a twin or a triple school, the footprint would be much smaller. And then finally, in step three, this same idea of converting the Conant facility to an early childhood center through renovations and additions. Obviously, that was three steps instead of one or two, and so the total time to complete the master plan would be much longer, with the final project happening occupancy as early as 2035. Part of the reason this middle step takes a little longer is because of the work that happens at the junior high would take one extra year as placing an addition here. Option L, we change grade configuration again. This is the existing grade configuration. These last two options are the closest to what you have today. In the first scenario, we truth tested replacing each of Douglas, Gates, and Conant sequentially on their own sites. And although the MSBA would require us to look at not only all new construction, but also addition and renovation, we cost estimated these as addition renovations. So step one would potentially be to replace Douglas on the Douglas site. And we truth tested that possibility. Again, here's the existing building. There's an addition to fix all of those educational issues that we identified early in phase two. Similarly, at Conant, placing a couple of additions to solve those educational issues. And I apologize, I failed to mention, but all of this noise that you see around the site are restrictions, areas where we either would need special permission or actually couldn't build at all. And so you can see that the existing building is in this restricted area, but our additions are outside of those restrictions. And then finally, that was step three. And again, so the time to completion is much longer than some of the other options, with the last project being occupied around 2034. In this case, unlike the others, the administration would need to retain pre-K, and pre-K would need to continue to exist at the Blanchard facility. And then finally, option M, same grade configuration. And again, we're replacing each of the three schools in kind with three schools. But in step one, it would be a twin school on the Gates site. And we've seen this diagram once already. And then a freestanding school on the Douglas property in step two. So similar timelines, 2022 for the first project and possible occupancy of the second project in 2028. We had each of those shortlisted items cost estimated, factoring in what we thought escalation might be, because obviously we're a long way from construction. These are high level, you know, conceptual cost estimates. They're based on the fastest possible completion. Obviously, if the MSBA doesn't meet what we think the timeline might be, the costs could be even a little higher depending on how far out they really are. And so for the option C, everything all inclusive to approximately $240 million. It does. In fact, you can just see the breakdown here. So new twin school at Gates is the top line. Anad Reno at Conant is the middle line. And capital improvements everywhere else in the district is the third line. So this isn't just the major projects. This is the ongoing capital improvements associated with the other buildings in the district as well. Rob, did you want to add something?
One of the reasons why we did this is to show consistency among all the options. You know, we didn't want to have, because of the consolidation and the varying levels of, you know, which schools get renovated and which ones don't under a particular option, you know, you may end up having varying numbers associated with each one. So this kind of presents a level playing field among all of the options and addresses all of the buildings, all of the schools that are in play in each option. Just wanted to kind of clarify that.
So I won't go through each one of these. Option C, option D, option E, which was the triple school, option I, which was the junior high, option L, and option M. So ranging from roughly $230 million to $280 million. And just to put this in a little context, I don't know how many of you have seen the recent Boston Globe article, but there's been a lot of news about the construction market in Massachusetts right now, and that the market is really hot. So to put your entire master plan in context, Waltham High School, the early cost estimates for just the high school are around the $250 million mark. Right, just a single building. That's not to scare anyone. That's just to sort of put, you know, these entire master plan costs in a little bit of context. So how do you boil down 18 months worth of work into just one slide? We're going to give it a go. So as we mentioned before, phase one identified that, you know, Douglas, Gates, and Conant were in the greatest physical need among the educational facilities. In phase two, we sort of corroborated that those same three elementary schools were in the greatest educational need. And so clearly the focus should lie with those three schools. We heard during our visioning session that the district, as part of its educational vision, is interested in exploring grade configurations other than what you have today. And I think we've successfully done that. In terms of the enrollment trajectory, we talked about this sort of trough phenomenon that's going to happen about 10 years from now, and that the housing stock is going to start to turn over. In fact, as I understand it, has already started to turn over a little bit in Boxborough. And so that enrollment trajectory is expected to go back up again over a 20-year time horizon. We heard a lot about twin and triple schools, that you have at least one twin school in your district now, that there may be some interest for economies of scale to pursue that again, but those twin schools may need to exhibit different features than what the Parker-Damon facility exhibits, and that based on our truth testing on sites, both twin and triple schools at least appear to be theoretically possible on the Gates property. And then in terms of the costs, we mentioned these two numbers previously. If the district continues to only pursue the capital improvement plan, that number over the next 10 years is in the neighborhood of $120 million, very little of which would likely be able to be participated in by the MSBA. So that's mostly on the two towns' dime. The master plan number for around $250 million, perhaps you could solve all of the physical needs and all of the educational needs and then also get the MSBA to assist with those, and therefore it would reduce the district's contribution to those projects. What's going to happen next? As we mentioned, our study is not concluding with a, you know, you should do this one thing. Instead, it's resulting in a short list of options. And so the dialogue is going to continue. That's the key message about next steps, right? The district and the two towns want to continue the conversation with the citizens. And the big decision on the table is about grade configuration. The district has already put in statements of interest to head down an elementary school path. If that continues to be the priority, then the discussion, once we enter into the MSBA process, can be about which, excuse me, which of these two elementary school grade configurations are most appropriate here in Acton-Boxborough. Should the district decide to change gears and pursue the conventional middle school grade configuration, a new statement of interest would have to be created and submitted to the MSBA, right? So essentially we'd have to, you know, start over again if that's what we think the best educational path is here in the district. So that's the big discussion right now. Is it an elementary priority or is it a middle school priority? And that's part of the dialogue that the district wants to continue with everyone. We have just turned over, and in fact, JD, you have it back there. We just turned over our final report this evening. We expect that that will be published on the district website in the next couple of days. I mentioned that the school committee wants to continue the discussion with you, further engagement with the general public. Tonight's the start of that. And then wait to see what the MSBA results on the statements of interest that were submitted in the spring are. I understand that the MSBA has already come out to visit at least once over the summer to have a dialogue with the district, but we're still awaiting official results of their disposition on those statements of interest that were submitted back in the spring. Should the district get invited? Right? SOIs submitted last spring. This is the rough timeline that led us to that 2022 occupancy. The MSBA has essentially 8 steps that you have to go through in their prescribed process, and there are time durations associated with all of them. The big picture message here is that the two towns would have opportunities to vote on the projects at least twice in terms of a formal vote. The first one would be to approve feasibility study funds. That's to get through the initial study stages and schematic design. That's the first contract, series of contracts that the district would enter into. And then after schematic design, there's a stage called the project funding agreement where the MSBA and the district both agree that this is the project we're going to pursue, this is the dollar amounts that we're going to contribute on both sides, and then the town gets to vote about whether or not they want to support that. All right, so there are at least two opportunities for the town, the two towns, to weigh in on funds and the direction of the project in this MSBA process. From start to finish, about 6.5 years. All right, with that, that was a lot of information in a relatively short window. What questions do you have? Yes, sir. Prakash.
For each of the funding options, have you also indicated approximate funding that will be provided by MSBA?
Did everybody hear the question? No? Okay. The question was, in our cost estimates, and correct me if I'm wrong, Prakash, did we essentially identify the two towns portion, or how much the MSBA is willing to contribute? The short answer to that is no. We do have a rough baseline reimbursement rate. For the high school, sure. So when the high school was built, which was under a different authority, around 43%, okay? Now it's important to note that this is a different awarding authority and the rules are a little bit different. When we say reimbursement rate, we want everybody to be on the same page that this is the starting reimbursement rate. There are certain caps that the MSBA puts on certain portions of the project which have a result of lowering the net reimbursement rate. So while you might start at 43%, once you dot all the I's and cross all the T's, the actual net effective reimbursement rate will be lower than that.
And it's only on building projects, not the capital improvement. And if there's multiple building projects, we might only get in for one. So it's hard for them to estimate now, but we'll do our best.
The other piece of that is MSBA looks at your reimbursement rate every year. So for us to project what it's going to be 6 years from now, it's really hard to do. But that kind of gives you a sense. And the other thing I just wanted to add before we get into more questions is the timelines that we proposed up there were based on the assumption, apples to apples through all the options, that you were entering into an MSBA project one at a time. They only take one building at a time. And in some communities, when you look at some of those timeframes, right, and we say that the option where we're keeping all existing and doing an addition to renovations, by the time you get into your third elementary school, you know, that's 18, 20 years from now. So a lot of communities have to start thinking about that in terms, especially at elementary when you have multiple, is the parity equity question, right? If we're gonna renovate one and you have one brand new school and then it's gonna take you another 18 years to get there, that's through an MSBA process. Some communities have elected to do it differently. You know, they get as much as they can from an MSBA project, and because of other reasons, they have to go and look at it, you know, local share. We're just providing you a view. We're not saying this has to be the schedule. We're making the assumptions that you're going to want to go through an MSBA process for each of the projects.
Do you know if they would consider a twin school one building?
Yes, they would.
In fact, we have another community where we're executing that idea currently. Yes.
Yeah, but you take that one.
Thank you. Just a follow-up to what we just discussed on a separate question. So that seems to imply that it's from the MSBA perspective, it's better to do like either the twin school, from that perspective, the twin school or the triple school, because then you're really only going in for one building. The likelihood that you're sort of somehow going to get MBSA or MSBA funding for one and then another and then another seems less likely. So I don't know, I'm just pointing out the obvious, but or maybe it's not, maybe it's not true. So you can confirm that. And then my second question is around, you know, you did the cost, the high-level cost estimates for just how much it would cost to construct all of these facilities. But you mentioned that different configurations of grades and schools have different implications, both educationally and I'm assuming financially. Mm-hmm. So I'm just wondering if you did any of that financial analysis or if that just feels like it's too far in the future, because yep. It would be interesting to understand that. I mean, certainly there's a lot of, there can be economies of scale, sometimes there's not, mm-hmm. But anyway.
So in our study, we did not formally look at the operational impacts
of these various options. In other words, we didn't crunch any data or try to project, you know, staffing counts or, you know, annual operating budgets for the various options. We worked with JD to anecdotally, when we went through the evaluation criteria, we recognized that that's an important thing to consider. And so we did do that anecdotally, but we didn't do it with any hard and fast data. More often than not, what we see is, should a district get invited into the MSBA process, and this kind of complexity is under consideration, that the district will embark on a side study to explore those exact issues and try to tie or project costs to a twin school versus a freestanding school, or transportation locating a building in this part of the district versus locating it in that part of the district. And when you're doing that in-depth feasibility study for a single project, that's the most appropriate time to do that so that you understand the nuances of that decision. In terms of the MSBA, there are lots of examples where the MSBA, even in its, you know, short 9-year history, has executed multiple projects in the same district. They just don't allow, historically, they don't allow districts to do more than one project at the same time. So it's up to the district, and in your case, the two towns, to decide what the greatest value is, right? Is it to bite off a little more all at once to try to hit as many students as possible, or do you take a smaller bite to, you know, have the financial advantage of that, knowing that the second step may or may not happen? But there is the possibility that the MSBA could participate on all of the projects, they just would have to be at least sequentially.
Yeah, I think that's an important piece. When MSBA comes on, they're a huge financial partner. So they are a partner with the district, and they're sitting at the table through all of these decision-making processes. And one of those is the option that the district is considering, you know, does the state also agree that that's an educationally viable grade configuration or number of kids in a building, et cetera, for the next 50 years, right? They're trying to solve your problem for the next 50 years so you're not knocking at the door again. So they are definitely a participant, a strong participant, in that detailed feasibility to ask those same questions that you guys are gonna ask yourselves. But there's just another person sitting at the table saying, we agree or don't agree.
Other questions? Yeah, Jason?
So I have a question about the MSBA reimbursement rates. Is it uniform across the Commonwealth, or do different towns get different levels? Is it needs-based? I mean, I'm looking at the Clark Avenue School that's being built in Chelsea, and that's a 65% reimbursement rate. What goes into that? What goes into that differential?
There's several different factors that get weighed into that reimbursement rate, and so it is. It's different from community to community, and it changes from year to year. And you know, sometimes they change their recipe on how they come up with that rate, but it's you know, part of it is you know, property values. Part of it is, you know, number of kids on free and reduced lunch programs, and there's several other factors that they use to combine to come up with, you know, a minimum base rate and, you know, maximum of, you know, 80%. So it's somewhere in that category, but it depends year to year. And, you know, specifically this would, in a district, it's going to be a blended rate because Boxborough most likely will be different from Acton's reimbursement rate.
And the second part of your question about, is it needs-based? The grant program is competitive in that way, that they'll have, you know, districts from all over the Commonwealth submit statements of interest, and in their review, they will prioritize those projects that they think are the most needy first. And so I think the numbers that we heard last year were, there were well over 100 districts submit statements of interest, and 23 got invited into their eligibility period, right? And often the statistics are even lower than that, year to year. Other questions? Yeah, Charlie, he's bringing you the microphone.
In the beginning of your presentation, you mentioned renovating the existing buildings or bringing them, doing the required maintenance. It's about $120 million. Is that the total cost of just using the existing buildings? And if so, why is that not one of the options?
Good question. So the $120 million, and Lee and Rob chime in here, is just the cost associated with keeping the buildings operating. New roofs, new windows, new mechanical systems, new plumbing systems if necessary, updating the building exterior, handicap accessibility, fire protection, all of those sort of basic physical building infrastructure things. What it doesn't include is putting the right number of classrooms at Douglas. It doesn't include right-sizing the gym at Douglas. It doesn't include making sure that all of the special education spaces are in appropriate learning environments, right? So it's just the physical things only. It's not solving any of those educational needs. And so, of course, it's always an option, but the consequence of that particular path is that these other educational needs would continue to be needs. Do you guys have other things to add to that?
The other consideration is that $120 million that we mentioned, if that and it is an option, and moving forward, that would be 100% district share, you know, to fund those costs over whatever period of time that you want to do it. Versus we also wanted to look at two things, solving those long-term educational needs and also getting the state to be the ability to participate in this financially. They would not participate in just an infrastructure-only project.
Yeah, but all of the other options were $230 million and up with, as you've just been discussing, an unknown potential reimbursement by the state, which may be as much as 40%, but probably would be less, we don't know. And you mentioned a couple of minutes ago, they get to sit at the table and tell you what you cannot do, which is not the case if you're renovating your own building using your own money. So what I'm hearing is that you got a cost estimate for taking care of the structures, but the educational part, I mean, how big a problem is it? Do we know? I mean, you know, just for those people who don't know what I'm going to say next, I've been in this town a long time. We educated a lot of kids during those years and in those buildings, and they all seem to manage to do pretty well. So what's the problem?
Fair enough. And this is why it's so important to continue the dialogue, right? Ultimately, this is a value decision that the two towns have to make. Are we willing to continue to educate children in the same environment that we have today? And if so, right, that's perfectly reasonable, and you know that's about a $120 million number. If the answer to that is no, we want to meet the state's guidelines for space, we want to, you know, solve some of these educational need issues, then that's going to cost more money, right? But ultimately, that's a decision that the two towns have to make, and it's a value decision that you have to have.
Well, I want to make sure we fully understand that. When is that decision going to have to be made?
Well, the district has already made the decision to submit statements of interest to the MSBA for these elementary school, at least one of these elementary school projects. So the schools committee has decided to at least engage the MSBA in the conversation, right? If I go back to this graphic, those decisions will be made at these two points, right? So let's say the MSBA says, yep, we're willing to participate. Then the two towns have the opportunity to say, well, we don't think this is a good idea at this stage. And you also have an opportunity to say it's a good or not idea at that stage.
Okay.
So the answer to that is yes, actually. The MSBA for the feasibility study portion will reimburse at the full rate for that first segment, right? The reduced net effective reimbursement rate doesn't kick in until we get to this step further down the road, and we're actually talking about detailed design and construction.
I have one last question. Has anybody done any calculation of how much any of this would impact our tax bill?
That's a good question. And does anybody know the answer to that? Mary's shaking her head that no, we haven't done that yet.
I have.
I have a question. I have a question also.
Yes.
It's a little bit of a follow-up question. So I actually have a lot of questions, but I'm just going to ask one. So what strings are attached with taking this, the state money? You talked about having someone at the table. We talked about educational needs that potentially want to address. If we take state money, are they going to say, oh yes, you have to meet these educational needs, or yeah, we have a checklist of things you have to do in your new building. So if we're getting 30% reimbursement, but we're spending an extra $50 million to jump through their hoops, it may still be worth doing if that's the choice, but it's not going to be as rosy as, oh, they're just giving us all this extra money.
Yeah, let me see if I can respond to that. The short answer is yes, there will be hoops to jump through. And it's quite a prescriptive process. I think it's really functional, but there are lots of hoops to jump through. The thing that the MSBA is interested in the most is that the resulting project is the most educationally appropriate and cost-effective solution possible, right? And they use that exact language. When they say educationally appropriate, what they mean is they want the district to define for itself what they want to do educationally, right? And there's a series of documents that have to be prepared that communicate that to the MSBA. Typically, they don't get involved with what the district wants to do educationally. What they will say is, whatever you've documented, your design has to support that. So if you wanted to do, you know, name something, multi-age looping, right? This is where there's a group of kids from different age groups in a single classroom, and they would loop with that teacher from one year to the next, right? That's sort of a non-traditional way of doing education. The MSBA would fully support that as long as your design matched that approach. Project-based learning, technology-based learning, whatever it is, right? You document what you want to do, your designer matches a facility to that, right? They're not going to dictate education to you. Now, that being said, in terms of the design, they're going to say, we don't want you to build classrooms that are smaller than 900 square feet. We're not going to let you build gymnasiums that are bigger than 6,000 square feet, right? There are some specific space guidelines. Should they be spaces that you need, they're going to ask you to fit in a window.
How big are those Douglas classrooms now?
The Douglas classrooms were among the only ones that were about right-sized.
Are they in compliance with those
guidelines? They are within 10% of the guidelines currently, yes. Yes. So does that answer your question that there are certain things you have to do, but they're not going to dictate your educational approach to you? Yes. I can't read your name tag if you have one. Jennifer. Can someone get Jennifer a microphone?
This gentleman right here.
I have questions. I'm sorry.
Oh, all right. Hold on, Jennifer. Go ahead.
Okay, I have two questions. The first is, all your designs show existing school properties. Were you dictated for that, or was that an assumption you made?
We talked a lot about available property in the two towns, and for purposes of the study, there wasn't a piece of property that anybody could point to that says, yep, that's the magic bullet. Let's go look at that piece of property. So when and if this process continues, there's always that opportunity. So even if, you know, a year from now we get invited into the MSBA study process, the two towns could say, hey, is there property to do a new building somewhere else, right? But for purpose of our study, we were confined to the locations of the existing buildings.
And if we had a different piece of property, would the cost be lower if we owned it already? Because we're not doing corresponding work?
Yeah, good question. Unfortunately, the answer is we don't know. For new construction, assuming a flat site and no unnecessary phasing required, the costs would probably be about the same, right? Because right now we're dealing at the sort of dollars per square foot scale of cost estimates. So whether we put it on this piece of property or we put it on that piece of property, the construction costs would probably be about the same. There would be some differences in site development costs, potentially. We don't know what the soils are or whether there are wetlands. And those would be nuances of the cost difference. But at this stage, we wouldn't have enough information to differentiate them in that way. Does that answer your question?
And the other question I had was, when you did all your studying in, I think it was phase one, K through six, et cetera, did you look at K through three and a 4-6 type of structure at all?
So that was actually in phase two. And envisioning session number two, we talked at length about grade configuration. And we did explore lots of other possibilities. When we did a particular exercise, we had people place dots
between grades where they thought the natural breaks were, and some of them were other combinations like pre-K two. But ultimately that group, you know, decided that these three that we've explored were the favorites, at least among the 80 people that were in the room, right? And again, this is the district and the towns aren't locked into anything at this stage, right? We were just directed to explore these grade configurations. When you get into the MSBA process, they allow you to explore any number of different grade configurations. That'll be a discussion you have with them during what's called the eligibility period. We actually had a client 2 years ago who we explored three different grade configurations on seven different sites. And so that generated a lot of different options. But there is that possibility inside the MSBA process to change your mind about grade configuration during that eligibility period phase. Jennifer, can we get the microphone down to Jennifer?
Two what I hope are very quick questions. So just to clarify, what is the life expectancy of a school, and when do we expect to have to deal with the other buildings in the district that were not mentioned as part of those three?
So the MSBA requires that their projects meet a 50-year life expectancy. Now, that's not that every single light bulb and, you know, fixture in the building is going to last 50 years, but that the major components are going to last 50 years. And so if you look at the current age of your buildings, some of them have already exceeded that 50-year life cycle. But, you know, if you take the high school addition renovation that was completed in 2002, right, it's probably okay for a good long while. It's going to need capital improvements, continued maintenance, roofs here and there, right? But it should be okay for quite a long while. It's those elementary schools that are in the greatest physical need, mostly due to their age.
And my second is more of a suggestion. I think it'd be helpful if we had a list of what educational needs are, because I don't think everyone who has children in the district anymore, and you keep referencing the gymnasium, well, that's one, but I presume we're dealing with issues like special needs not being taught in hallways anymore.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so actually, in our report, we have a specific section related to educational analysis and space needs identification. And so we enumerate for each building what the specific needs are. We just didn't include them in this presentation for time's sake. But you're exactly right on the character of those. Those are the kinds of things that we're talking about.
Hi.
Hi.
You mentioned that the committee of the board has submitted an SOI with MSBA. Was it done with a certain option, a particular option that you outlined, or was that a more general document?
Nope. So the MSBA will allow districts to submit as many statements of interest as they'd like, but they do force districts to identify the one priority. So correct me if I'm wrong, but I think the district submitted three statements of interest, one for Douglas, one for Gates, and one for Conant, and identified Douglas as its priority. But the statements of interest were written in such a way to not lock the district into a Douglas-only project. So even if the MSBA says, yep, Douglas is the priority, let's pursue that, there's enough wiggle room in there that the district could pursue a twin school solution or even a triple school solution if it so chose. What the district couldn't do is say, no, just kidding, we want to do a middle school. Right? That wouldn't be allowed. That would mean we'd have to submit a new statement of interest and start over. Yeah. I don't know where Rob's going.
I'm trying to get there. I'll start in the middle.
Thank you. Can I go back to the question that Charlie asked about the $120 million worth of improvements?
Sure.
And does that include dealing with the modulars in those buildings and taking those offline and replacing those as part of your look at maintenance costs?
It does not.
Okay.
Those would remain.
Correct.
And the life cycle on those is?
Typically, the life cycle on a modular unit is somewhere around 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
So there you go.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
It's not uncommon for them to get placed and then be around for much longer than that.
But again, this is one of those value judgments. Is that an educationally appropriate learning environment?
Okay.
But the $120 million does not include...
Does not include that.
...replacing those.
And then my other question is, does the $120 million, is that just for the three elementary schools that are under discussion, or does that include needed deferred maintenance
That's
at district-wide. The junior high and high school as well as the other elementary
it's
schools?
It's district-wide over a life cycle of about 10 years, and does it include the administration and maintenance building as well?
Yes, it does.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, you are.
Okay, Tom.
So we're still fairly early in the elementary regionalization. I don't know how many students currently cross town lines to attend Acton students in Boxborough or Boxborough students in Acton. Now, these projects are elementary schools in Acton, and I'm just wondering what the temperature of Boxborough is, because both towns, I assume, have to approve these funds and stuff, and I've not, what is the value seen for Boxborough for these projects?
Good question. I think you would have to ask them, but what our physical assessment demonstrated was that Blanchard was in better physical condition than the three elementary schools that we've identified in Acton, and it had less educational need than the elementary schools. So it's not that anybody was prioritizing Acton over Boxborough. It's just a fact of the data that those three elementary schools appeared to be in more need by both metrics than Blanchard did.
So I'm on the school committee and from Boxborough. I think part of our work in doing this is to present it to both communities and get both communities to agree if that's the way that the groups that are contributing to it think we should go. So it will be work. There's going to be an incredible amount of outreach that needs to happen through this process. But we have Boxborough FinCom members here. We have Boxborough School Committee members here. We have Boxborough community members here. So we are all interested. And Boxborough students will have access to these schools. It is a regional school district.
So getting back to the $120 million, is there a plan associated with that? I understood it was just like a compilation of all the things you saw wrong in a current day cost estimate of what it would cost to fix them. To actually do it, we'd have to shut down the entire education system for a year, fix all the schools, and then open it up again. Or is there a phase? Does it have cost escalation in it? All that.
So the answer to that is it was set up as an a la carte menu by school, prioritized with our view of the items that were in question. We prioritized needs over a 3 to 5 year time frame, you know, longer than that and then longer needs. So there was three different time frame buckets to be able to look through. There's certainly a lot of work to do if that's an option that you're going to start working on that capital improvement plan on how we package the projects. And you have to package them in a way that you can still have a school that's functional and operational. You know, a lot of work over on CIP plans, you know, tries to take place during summer months when school's out of session. But if it's going to be a situation where it displaces students because it's invasive, then you have to come up with temporary space for the student. So,
exactly my point.
Right. So, while
so is there a plan to do that, or is it just kind of like it's a number, but it's not really a comparable option to what we're looking at?
Yeah, the next steps that have to happen is moving forward on that and packaging projects. But there's a lot of discussion that needs to happen about, you know, what is the appetite for cost outlay over a certain amount of time. Mm-hmm. And depending on that, you know, you're going to package your projects a little bit differently. A lot of that has to do with, does an MSBA project take place? And then is it one school, two school, three elementary schools that are in consideration, right? And that takes a big chunk of that off of the plate. So it's a living document. It's used in school facility software that the district is using right now so they can be able to track that. And as they knock items off of it, they can update it as new things come on, because they will. You know, you need to be able to update that. But to your point is there's more planning that has to be involved in execution of different projects within that capital improvement plan.
Okay.
And I'll just add, you know, the reason why a lot of school districts move forward with putting together this capital improvement plan is so that you move away from, you know, this reactive-based, you know, operation maintenance every year where, you know, you have an emergency. Well, the boiler just went. I guess we got to replace that. Or, you know, well, we just had a roof leak. I guess we got to replace the roof now. So this plan, and it is a capital improvement plan, has about 7 different categories of work, from handicap accessibility to code improvements to maintenance and energy efficiency, and then prioritizes, like Lee said, you know, immediate, short term, long term, and so what it does is helps the school district kind of plan ahead, and now you're in a proactive approach to maintaining your buildings.
Some of that $120 million list, some of those items can be handled through a yearly operating budget. Some of those items can be handled through district employees right now. But some of that is going to be more significant than you can do in an operating budget. And it's going to have to be packaged as a bondable project to be paid off over a period of time. So making those decisions is something that's still on the plate for the district.
Well, my point is I think it's going to cost more than $120 million to do it. And it's going to take more than a year to do it. So, as an option, I don't think it's fully vetted. Now, I wouldn't be in favor of it, but as an option, I think we have to get a more accurate number than we can do it for 120 or we can do it for 250. That, to me, is too simplistic a comparison.
Marie, did you want to add something to that? Rob, can you take the microphone back to Marie?
I'll be quick. Just that the $120 million, that slide that had all the red and orange stays red and orange. So it does not provide any additional space or any right sizing of space. And in our current environment, I think there are 7 or 8 modulars. They're all between 10 and 20 years old. And even with that space, which won't be here in 10 years, unless we pay the money to replace them, we have at least 3 schools that have 3 special education programs in one space or one classroom. And we have 250 English language learners who don't have classrooms, who we're trying to convert closets and small spaces and on and on and on. So it is different, and times have changed, and our student body has changed, and the space is not making it happen. And we're over class size because we don't have any other classrooms to move kids.
So in the interest of time, the questions have been really great. We'll take one more question, but then we have a feedback exercise at the end where you can provide additional input and even ask additional questions that we're going to record over on the boards. How do I pick? All right, 2 more questions. Fair enough.
We've heard a lot about the cost tonight and what things will cost and everything. I'm more from a less tangible viewpoint on it. What has appeared in the presentations is that the majority of the options, what I've seen, is a double or triple school at Gates, and this probably was not within the scope of your project, but I'm curious as how that turned up as so significantly when it is in a dense neighborhood with very poor access, is located adjacent to a floodplain, and also is very close to an active railroad line, not the school per se, but the roads getting to the school, with the fact that there's already buses and traffic stacked up there, as well as people bringing their students to the school, and you're going to double or triple the number of students in that area. That doesn't seem to fit very well with possible other options.
Understood. And I think this the response to that is fairly simple. When we looked at the existing sites that the district had available and the site restrictions that each site had on it, I think walking in the door, most of us thought that the Conant site was going to be the larger of the two developable properties, but it turned out that Douglas actually has the most room. Gates. Gates has the most room, and therefore that was the only place that we could even explore testing those scenarios. So there may be negative aspects to those particular options, but putting the twin and triple schools on that particular site was simply a result of how much area was buildable area was available.
And I'll just add that, you know, this is a, you know, 30,000 foot view study of, you know, this phase two is based upon educational planning. And so our job was really just to see, well, you know, will this actually fit on one of your existing school properties? And we really, it was out of our purview of the scope of our study to really go much further than that in terms of site analysis and traffic studies and so forth. We, you know, on those images, the graphic images that we had up there, you know, we did shade the wetlands areas so we kind of knew, and the buffers off of them, so we knew, you know, generally speaking, where, you know, the building could actually sit. But all of those things that you mentioned are excellent points, and those would be pursued further in the next level of study. Should MSBA, for example, say, yes, you're eligible, enter into our program, you would start to begin to scope out further, you know, are the, you know, will these building, should the building, you know, could the building sit on this site? Does it make sense? Do we start looking at other options for sites and so on?
Okay, Paul.
Run faster, Rob.
So I don't mean to perseverate on the $120 million option, but I was just curious if that included bringing the buildings up to ADA compliance?
Yes. All right, so what we'd like to do to conclude the evening is do a feedback exercise, and I'll give you those instructions in just a minute, because I think what we'll do, given the time, is we'll ask you to complete this exercise, and if you want to linger around to see what other people write, that's perfectly fine, but we won't have a wrap-up after you respond to the prompts we're going to give you. And so before I give you the instructions, Glenn wants to say a couple of closing comments.
Thank you, Jason. Four next steps, if I may just take a moment to share with you as I see them right now. First off, this report has now been finalized, and the school committee technically receives that report. We will get the PDF versions of that report up on our district website. We actually, if you've seen it already, thank you for visiting. If you haven't, we'll draw your attention to it. There's a branch or a page off of the district's website that we're amassing all of the information that has been talked about tonight, except this final report. We'll make sure that that's posted on there. The second next step is that at the most recent school committee meeting, they approved a subcommittee entitled the District Master Plan Working Group. Correspondence went out on Monday, I think it was, of this week to all of our families and trying to get that out to our community. And that proposal, that subcommittee rather, includes school committee representation as well as parents, guardians, and community members. And the intent or the charge, if you will, of that group is to receive this report, dig into it, understand it, and serve as the body that will help formulate the outreach to Acton and Boxborough communities to gather feedback. One of the key things that I am clear on through a couple of conversations with the MSBA is that if we are invited into the MSBA process, which, as I understand it, will be in February, one of the key things over the span of the next approximately 6 months or so, 4 to 6 months, is that, as I understand it, what the MSBA has indicated is that what we as a community or the school committee, I suppose, will need to do is to provide clarity around which of the different options that are in this district master plan there might be no interest to pursue. And that was very specific in terms of the language shared, and I actually asked it twice on two different occasions to be clear. You've heard about a number of different options, obviously, specifically including the grade configurations. And as I understand it, one of the things, one of the first and important charges for this working group will be to try and gather feedback around where does the interest lie across the communities for the options that have been presented, whether that be a twin school or a reconfiguration of grades. And if there is no interest based upon the feedback, then that can be appropriately signaled in time to the MSBA. And as I understand it, they won't pursue that. But so that's a, that'll be a key thing, along with certainly the outreach for that committee. The third thing, of course, is to wait the response from the MSBA, which, as I mentioned, will come anticipated in February. And fourthly, and you've heard reference to this, certainly work has begun to work on the capital improvement plan, the $120 million list, as we work through, try and prioritize that, try and better understand one of the great advantages that we do have in the district, and that is under JD Head, the staff and district, that unlike some districts, they don't have their own electrician or plumber or the like, and we do, and that certainly can be a benefit for us as we try and analyze that. And just in case you're wondering, as a point of interest, as a very round number, within our operating budget right now, we have about $500,000 towards capital. So I think it's just worth noting as we try and get a hold of all of this and plan ahead. I mentioned at the beginning, Acton TV was kind enough to record this. It will, as soon as it's edited, I'll make sure that that is made available for our community and others here to be able to watch the presentation tonight. And as mentioned, the final report will be posted online. Thanks for taking time tonight to come out.